Hello there, I am James Swanick and I'm joined today by my business and life coach, Ty Lopez. How are you, Ty?
Hey, James.
Great to have you here. Today we're going to be talking to Ty about how he reads a book a day, how he taught me how to read a book a day, about his business philosophy, about his life philosophy. I've just finished working with Ty for 12 months and as a mentoree. Is that how you say it, or is it a mentee? What's the student? See, I can't even
That's
get it
right. That's
a
good question.
He was my mentor and I was the student. He was Yoda and I was Luke Skywalker for 12 months. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about that.
But that means he's the good looking one.
Yeah. But before I tell you a little bit about that process and what I learned from Ty and what Ty taught me, Ty, tell the listener and the viewer right now a little bit about yourself.
Well, so I'm an investor. That's my main business, but... it's been interesting in the last, I don't know, years. I've gotten the opportunity, kind of like what happened to me. I've had five mentors, five people who, or I should say main mentors that helped me, critical people, starting at 18 years old, entrepreneurs, most of them business people. And so as I've been an entrepreneur, it's kind of evolved that you end up working together with people, sometimes informally with me and you, a little more formally, all with the end goal. You know, like what my end, I tell people, you got to focus on your end game goal. So my end game goal to this whole thing is, how can I end up with 300 people that I've worked with that are like you? We've become like more like business partners over time. Some people that I've acted more like an accelerator, or what they call an incubator, to help people with their ideas, and they go off on their own. But you know what the world needs now is not 1,000 more people running after get rich quick schemes, 1,000 more Paris Hiltons and Kim Kardashians running after luxury. What the world needs, both on an individual level and a big societal level, is people who are building solid foundations. Mm-hmm. That's why I worked with you. And even though we worked together for 12 months, I tell people realistically, you know, it takes about 18 months. And that's, you know, Peter Drucker's kind of time frame, this 18-month time frame. And it's kind of like cycles of nature. You know, you have to go through winter, mm-hmm. spring, summer, fall, as we've been working together. You know, usually people start out working with you, it's like the winter or the spring. Start to get, of course, everybody wants to be in the fall. That's mm-hmm. when you harvest. Mm-hmm. But that, you know, Bill Gates started at 12. He wasn't a billionaire till 31. Mm-hmm. It's a 19-year cycle. Warren Buffett started at 7, 57, I think, when he was a billionaire. Ray Kroc, you know, Mahatma Gandhi, Mother Teresa. There's this, they call it the 10 dark years. And I'm trying to shorten that because... most people, most of us, myself included, in modern world, we're too ADD. If I tell people it's going to take me 10 years to get you on the path, people give up before they even started.
Yeah. I'm impatient as well. I'm not a very patient guy.
We all are.
I want now, impatient. Now, now.
Right. But you've made, I mean, you're doing big things now. And I saw a Denzel Washington movie the other day. Not that you want to get your advice from Denzel, but the, one of the characters, he said, I'm looking for progress, not perfection. So I think most, if you're watching this, I apply the same thing to myself. It's like, that's why I tell people, it's a phrase you'll hear a lot, you've heard a lot, if you know, you end up working on any of this stuff and the systems that I have, it's all end game goal. So it's like, what is your end game for you? You know, your end game is clearly successful businesses, helping people, kind of a teacher, your background, mm-hmm. being on camera, mass media, reaching. And so every day when you feel discouraged, you have to go, like Charlie Munger says, the self-made billionaire, he's like, go to bed a little bit wiser, a little bit closer. But most people are going to bed maybe smarter, but not necessarily to the end. So you pick the goal here. Mm-hmm. Most people, you know, as you learn in geometry or you know, simple math, the quickest way between two points is a straight line. So most people, they maybe make progress, but they're going that way. But the goal is here. It doesn't matter how quickly you get to your goal, as long as you're going relatively directly towards it.
So when you were younger, before you became successful, you employed mentors, did you? Or you just worked with mentors, you worked for them for free, you paid them, like what? And what impact did they have on your life, which ultimately put you in a position to be able to be a mentor for people like me and maybe the viewer in the future?
Well, I talk about that. I did a TED talk and I kind of laid out what happened to me. And so it started out just almost by accident. I was in high school, or graduating high school, 18 or 19 years old. And this guy who had a farm, Joel Salatin, who now has become pretty famous, back then he was still, you know, our young dude. And he said, I'm doing an apprenticeship. That's what he called it.
Mm-hmm.
So they call it, I just came back from Germany on a speaking tour in Europe, and they call it apprenticeships, which is similar to mentor. And the guy, by the way, that was in Germany, he does a 2.5 year one. He found that's how long it takes, about 2.5 years. So I ended up, interestingly enough, I ended up at Joel Salatin's for almost 2 to 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
So that was on a farm.
Yeah.
Which was, to me, you know, I grew up in a city, I was born in Los Angeles, and there was character traits that I didn't have that really you only learn on a farm.
Mm-hmm.
So Joel Salatin was my first mentor, but also a farm environment was, you know, you learn hard work, you learn cycles, you learn patience. There's not a farmer in the world that puts corn, a seed of corn in the ground, and then comes back the next day and goes, I'm ready to eat.
Yeah.
But you know, there's a lot of stuff if you go on the internet. I was talking to a guy that's in one of my programs, the Inner Circle program, like what you're in, and he said, you know, Ty, I want to get my cash flow up. Here's a course I saw on how to make $10,000 a month. And I was going, you know, that old saying, when you're playing poker, after 30 minutes, if you don't know who the sucker is, you're the sucker.
Yeah.
And like, that's what you'd be like if you were on a farm and you plant, someone had a bag of corn that said, plant this today and tomorrow you will have a harvest. Like Jim Rohn, the great, you know, by the way, answering your question, I've had 5 mentors in person, but I've also read and use people like Jim Rohn, who's dead.
Mm-hmm.
He has a great saying where he goes, how does it go? He said, you can't harvest in spring if you haven't planted. I'm sorry, you can't harvest in the fall if you haven't planted in the spring. And too many of us, we're so impatient. We're not straight line and direct. We forgot those lessons. You know, 1901, about 90% of the world lived on a farm or in rural. Now we all live in cities, and cities are very, not that I'm against cities. Obviously, we're here in Hollywood, you know, in my house, and I live in a city, but the principles of having to put in your time and having to toughen it out. And so what I learned from these guys is that's all about the grind, and you have to learn to love the grind, because if you don't love the grind, then you're constantly chasing mirages. That's what I say. Most people are zombies chasing mirages. What do I mean by, I mean, you know, Thoreau said the mass of men lead lives of quiet desperation. What is called resignation is confirmed desperation, meaning unthinking, just kind of responding to the environment. If you read the book On the Shortness of Life by the philosopher Seneca, he says, you know, that it's not that life is short, it's that we waste most of it, just passing time. So not only, though, that's bad enough to be a zombie, and there's been times in my life when I've been a zombie too. I'm not excluded from this. But then what the worst thing is, we're also zombies chasing mirages, meaning they don't even exist. There is no end game goal. You know, people are trying to, let's say, figure out how to make recurring income where you don't have to work. I'm not sure that exists. I've never met people like that. The better question is, like you, you're doing it right. What's your natural giftings? What you feel okay about? You know, you're kind of a social guy. You're good on camera. You know, I talk about in the 67 Steps program that I built is this Eulerian destiny. And that's a fancy way of saying, like, figuring out what you should do. You know, you got a lot of years in being on camera on ESPN and all these things. Naturally, you when you're not working, you interact with people and you get energy from that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the things that you're doing now in business, whether you make 50 grand an hour now or 50 grand in a month or whatever that number be, you are moving not towards a mirage. You're moving to something that'll be real. And if you stick with it long enough, and you will see this, it does become real.
Mm-hmm. So we're sitting here in the home of Ty Lopez, who's been my mentor and coach for the past 12 months. And we're sitting in front of a bookshelf filled with, what do we saw? Hundreds of books here? Hundreds of books.
So all around my house, there's thousands probably, but something yeah. like that, yeah.
So Ty reads a book a day. And now I read a book a day. Now, just to clarify, on the days that I read a book, I read a book a day. It's right. not 7 days a week at the moment, but I'm up right. at four a week at the moment. I think you read a book a day, do you?
Yes.
Okay.
So I sometimes miss it, and then what I do is make up for it.
Okay.
So like when I was traveling in London, I got behind by a week, and I just read five or six or seven books. Like, I just forced myself to yeah. be down, which is not the best way to do it, but it's better to try to keep up to my... what I say I do, I try to keep up to it. I don't always do it, but pretty close.
So one of the great benefits that I got from working with Ty for the duration the time that I did was I had now learned the skill how to read a book a day. Now, it doesn't take me a full day to read it. It takes me now between an hour and 2 hours to read a book. And I've created that time in my day. I sit down and I read it. And if you following here from the podcast, if you go back a little while, you'll see how I read a book a day, and I produced a podcast episode where I detailed that. I actually just stole it right from this guy here to the left of me. But that's one of the great skills that I've now picked up on. So why do you read a book a day? Why is it so important, and what are the benefits from it?
Well, and just a side note, I steal away most of the good ideas that I have, I've stolen. So when people steal from me, I'm all good. Mm-hmm.
Well, just to interrupt for yeah. a second, Picasso said, "Good artists steal and great artists no, good artists copy, great yeah. artists steal." Exactly. I even butchered the quote there. You know, you've told it to me so many times.
Well, you got
and
it.
Then I,
you got
on the it. Moment of truth, I absolutely butchered it.
So, you know, Picasso is right. Good artists copy, great artists steal. Charlie Munger, who is a person I hasn't mentored me personally, but I follow what he says, and or I follow what he talks about speeches, and he says, you know, I believe in the discipline of mastering the best that other people have come up with. He says, I don't think you can just sit down and come up with it all yourself. Mm-hmm. Nobody's that smart. And that's coming from a guy who may have one of the highest IQs in the world. You know, Bill Gates, Warren Buffett say he's the smartest guy they've ever met. So if that guy, who is much smarter than me, looks at this world. Remember, you got 7 billion people in the world now. What do you want? You want the good life. If you're watching, you want the good life. I want the good life. Well, so do 7 other billion people. When it comes to business, it's competitive. I mean, what is the reality of the world that we're in now, and the nature of economics and capitalism, basically, the whole world's capitalistic now. Even the non-capitalistic ones are very, China's very capitalistic. And so within that world, you have a choice. And the way I tell people, I say, if you got an airplane, right, today, 747, you're flying on a vacation to the Bahamas, and a voice comes over the intercom, and the pilot says, "Hey, I'm your pilot today, and I've got good news. This is the first plane I've ever gone on. You are my first people. I never even tried this before." Every one of us would get right off that plane. But what you want is a pilot who first
yeah.
has done simulation. That means sat in an artificial environment and flown and crashed in the artificial one. Once he or she no longer crashed in the simulator, then they could go and be a co-pilot. With a mentor who is the head pilot. So it's so obvious for us when it comes to flying a plane, which is pretty complicated. But when I meet people who want to make $1 million business or $1 million, they're like, "No, I'm just going to go out and wing it." And I'm like, "No, it's more difficult to make $1 million. There's more pilots that have been trained than there have been highly successful people with a lot of impact. So, but you got to take the best. You got to go and what's the best way to mentally simulate something? It's to read.
Yes. Before I started working with you, I probably read 3 books a year, quite frankly, and that was it. I got a lot of my education from YouTube videos, which is very effective, which is great. And a lot of podcasts as well. Listen to podcasts, and I got a lot of education that way. When I first started reading a book in an hour or two, like you taught me, it was tough. It was tough to set the routine of doing it and to actually get into it. But then after, surprisingly, after 1 week only, probably 4 books, all of a sudden it just became, oh, okay, I've got this now. Now it just became second nature. Yep. Then I made it part of my routine. I'd wake up in the morning, I'd go to the gym, I'd come back, I'd shower, and I would create a 90-minute block where I'd sit down with that book and I would read the book.
Yep.
And when I closed it, and then I headed off to work that day, I felt infinitely more educated and smarter and so much more knowledge in my brain. I read Poor Charlie's Almanac, which is the book by Charlie Munger, who's the business partner of Warren Buffett, two of the richest men in the world.
Yeah.
A great book, Evolutionary Psychology by Professor David Buss, which is all about mating choices, why a certain man chooses a certain woman, why men are attracted to blonde hair versus brown hair, you know, all these things over evolution, which was fascinating. The Snowball Effect, which is a biography about Warren Buffett as well, got it getting into his mind. And the list just goes on. So what are your 3 favorite books, or what books would you recommend to the viewer right now that they should watch to really increase their education?
Right. Well, so, you know, on my site, I put up, I use this Dunbar's number. Our brain evolved, a sociologist, Robin Dunbar, said we're adapted to be able to handle about 150 friendships, relationships. So I use that number for books. So, you know, on my site, I've got these 150 books. If I had to narrow it down, and it's a struggle to try to put them in order, because I can come up with a top 20. It's harder to come up with a top 3. But if I had to come up with a top 3.
I'm holding a gun to your head. Hey,
okay, right. Right now. I would probably say Dr. David Buss's Evolutionary Psychology textbook.
And it's not a small book either. It's quite big.
It's easy to read. Hard to read.
It's not hard to read, but it's like one of the, when you get it in the mail, you order on Amazon.
Yeah, you're like, uh-oh.
And it's like $70 and it comes, it took me back to my high school years where you get those big, thick, ugly school books and you got to learn it for chemistry or physics and you're like, oh my God, I've gone back 20 years here.
Yes. But that one is not that painful.
No, it's not.
That one's fun.
And there's lots of pictures.
Yes. Yeah. There's lots of pictures. And it's entertaining because it's on subjects that are relevant to you and I. It's not on chemistry or, you know, bizarre scientific principles that don't apply every day. There's a little book called it's called A Civilization and Its Discontents by Sigmund Freud.
Yeah, I read that one too.
Man, that one is, you gotta read it. That one you have to read about 10 times. It's short. You're talking 20 pages maybe. Then the third book, gosh, man, I would say
Managing Oneself, Peter Drucker?
Maybe, yeah, maybe. I would say
The Empire. Raoul Dahl, James and the Giant Peach.
Yeah.
I'm just joking with that
you
one.
You know what's another good? Maybe The Selfish Gene by Richard Dawkins.
Yeah.
I had another one in my... So, Will Durant.
Oh yeah,
actually, that would put Will Durant. So,
Lessons of History is like Will Durant's. Yeah. It's like 12 massive, huge books. Is it
9,900 pages for all of them? So that's a cheat answer. I would say that book. Those are the most important books I've ever read.
Don't get the encyclopedias, or do get the encyclopedias if you're going to commit to reading it for 1 year.
Those are a lifetime.
Yes,
man. I read those every week. I pick them randomly. But Will Durant, a short one, you know, he wrote one called On the Meaning of Life. That one is intense. They found a whole bunch of Will Durant that he never published. Mm-hmm. He died in his 90s when his wife died, and there was a whole bunch of manuscripts that one guy published.
Mm-hmm.
So anything by Will Durant. He won Pulitzer Prize for a reason.
Mm.
I think Will Durant may be the wisest, smartest person of human civilization, if I had to get one.
Because he's studied so much.
Right.
So it's not naturally the smartest person.
Well, he was...
because he's gone out and studied history and he's seen...
Yes.
Like, civilizations...
Yes.
...being destroyed and then rebuilt.
Right.
And studied, like, human conquests and all that kind of stuff.
And he studied the greatest people. So yeah. I'm big on, you know... This kind of hits a nerve with some people. Some people take it... well, and some people don't, but I think you have to be humble and you have to realize that the great advances in your life, the things that you like about being alive now, which are, you know, the modern conveniences, the fact that if you break your arm, you're not going to die.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that you have control over, you know, Will Durant says one of the measures of progress is your ability to control your life. Like right now, it's not like it was if you were born in the Middle Ages. In the Middle Ages, if you were born a serf, a vassal of some earl or king, you would have to work the land for him.
Mm-hmm.
You had no freedom of career. Depending on what civilization and time you were born, you might not have any choice who you marry.
Mm-hmm.
You might be married off just for political reasons or money. But today, now... And this is a catch-22 because there's some bad things that come with it or some painful things. The world we live in now, you have tremendous choice, right? You have the choice of what career to pursue.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like a religion that you grew up with, no one's going to make you go to church. Mm-hmm. No one's going to force you. If you don't like somebody, you can quit your job. There's no... So, Will Durant... So what Will Durant is study the greatest people. Now, along with that, the reason that you and I enjoy all these freedoms is because of the great thinkers.
Mm-hmm.
The people who invented electricity so they can watch this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Thomas Edison or Tesla. The people with the big biological breakthroughs so that now you don't die at 30 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Charles Darwin. You know, Darwin is the basis of modern biology.
Mm-hmm.
Albert Einstein, physics, and the things that we can do now. So we are happy to follow the great people
mm-hmm.
on those things with technology.
Yes. Say,
doctor, hospital. No one goes in. You break your arm, you go in the hospital. They're not going to be like, ah, well, I think you should use a homemade remedy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, put some roots and stuff on your arm and hope it gets better. But the problem is when it comes to your life today, you and I forget that we can do the same thing. We can find what do the great philosophers and thinkers say about what we eat today. What diet should you be on? And what should you do to be happy? What should you do to find love?
Mm-hmm.
What should you use to make money?
Mm-hmm.
We want to try to figure it out all on our own, and it doesn't work that way.
Yeah, so we can't figure it out on our own.
We can, but it'll take too long.
We can, but it'll take too long.
You can't while you're young. You'll be 90, and then you'll be like, I figured it out.
Yeah. But a good start is to read books, right?
Absolutely. It'll accelerate. If you want to take 20 extra years to get what you want, don't read anything.
Yeah.
You'll be good, but you'll be 20 years older when you get what you want.
Yeah. My thinking has changed dramatically since I learned the skill of reading a book a day. I find I'm more productive. I have context in my life now. It's awoken these ideas and thought processes in my mind that I never knew existed. My relationships with people are much more amicable now. Not that they weren't beforehand, but if I was prone to irritability previously, now I'm not. And that just comes from context. I've also been able to really focus on my business a lot more because I've tapped into the minds of great entrepreneurs like Warren Buffett, like Bill Gates, like Jeff Bezos, who created Amazon, simply from reading their books. And it's one of the great skills that Ty has passed on to me and which I hope to pass on to my children one day, and that is the art of reading a book. Now, of course, you can go onto YouTube and type in Warren Buffett on investing, or you can type in the Dalai Lama on philosophy, or you can type in Mother Teresa on caring, and that's super effective. But I find that now just sitting down and creating that space to read a book really implants it into my brain. And since then, I've made great strides. Working with you for a year, Ty, what have you seen in me in terms of my progression from reading the book and from, you know, skill sets that I may have gained?
Well, I think you have more, like you said, context, perspective, see the big picture. I think you've got more patience. I think you've got more focus. These are all these things that are unfortunately not taught to anybody. I mean, I always say, and this doesn't mean to put down parents or anything, but most of us, our parents were more guardians. Mm-hmm. Right? They kept you from doing drugs. They kept you from being out late. They made sure you went to school. But in terms of equipping you with what you need in the four pillars of life, health, wealth, love, and happiness, they didn't do that. Mm-hmm. And that's a societal thing, I think. It's just parents live up to what they're expected to do. So mm-hmm. it becomes for you and I to learn it. And the worst thing is, it doesn't matter how old you are, you still have to learn it. Yeah. If you haven't learned it at 60, you either... It's like Alexander the Great says. He said, there's only two types of people in the world. The first, conquer fear. And the second, don't conquer it and suffer and die. And so the things that you have to know, it's the same way. You either learn how life works. You learn how to get health, wealth, love, and happiness. Learn it from somebody else. In-person mentors, books. Or you don't. And you suffer and die. And mm-hmm. that's most people's life. If you look at it, they have little streaks of days where they're feeling accomplished. But most people, like Thoreau said, are leading lives of quiet desperation. They're not really that healthy. Mm-hmm. They're not really that wealthy. Mm-hmm. Their love relationships, their social ties are not that good. Mm-hmm. Whether it be marriage, divorce, or friends and family. You know, most people only have a lot of friends when they're 20. By the time they're 50, they have one friend left. And then they're not that happy. They don't. And more important than happiness, because happiness comes and goes, it's that fulfillment where you get up out of bed and you tap dance to work. And obviously that ebbs and flows for everybody. It's an emotion. But for you, as you're going down this path, and I don't even know, it's hard to even realize it, you've been rewiring your brain, right? And the good news about life, you know, there's the saying, you know, you reap what you sow. If you sow seeds, corn seeds, then eventually, if you water it, you'll get corn. If you throw down weeds, seeds, you'll eventually get weeds. And so for you, it's been a year, and I feel like, you know, you're kind of in the spring, summer, you're planting a lot of stuff. Good news is what goes around comes around. You've been putting books into your head. You've been building more focused business. You know, one of the big things that I didn't talk about, you've been getting to know yourself, which I think is one of the hardest things. You know, that's the Oracle of Delphi. Plato, Socrates, Aristotle was like, you went to the Oracle, the wisest, and the answer was know thyself. Mm-hmm. And, interestingly enough, we all think we know ourselves, but I was just reading Nietzsche. He wrote a book, Man Alone with Himself, and he says, but we are an impenetrable fortress. And he says that really the only way, like the subconscious is almost an impenetrable force. It's only through friends and enemies that you begin to know yourself. So friends are obviously, you know, mentors. I'm a friend. We're working together. But it's also enemies, which are not always people, but it's the hardships of life. Mm-hmm. So I think over the year, you reflect on what's all the things that have gone well, and what are all the things that I don't like. And those are the enemies, and those two things break us all out of our shell. So you begin to go, I'm James Swanick. Here's the things I can do, and here's the things that I can't do. And, you know, when we worked together at the beginning, I wanted you to do some stuff that's not who you are, like a lot of technical stuff, because I wanted you to get over that challenge and know that a man can do anything as long as it's not forever, right? That is the process of knowing yourself as you go through these things, because sometimes we just say, oh, no, I'm not good at that, but you actually are. And sometimes we say we're not good at that, and it's actually true you're not. And I think over this year, you go through things, you saw the experimentation mode, but now in the last three or four months, now we've released, it's like the sculpture of your life. This is a big rock. You come at the beginning, It's not chiseled down. The beginning, you make big chunks get knocked off. It can be a little painful. And then at the end, the thing just starts to smooth down, which is, I think, where you are now. And then all you have to do is wait and continue on. Not just wait passively, but continually. And then you start to reap what you sow.
Yeah. So if you're watching right now and you would like to make more money, have better health, understand what it is that you want to do in life, if you're stuck at the moment and you're not sure, you don't know what your life's destiny is, if you want to learn business, how to get a business off the ground or improve your business, if you want to see life from a much broader perspective rather than this tunnel vision that you may think you're in right now, then I would absolutely recommend you working with Ty in one of his coaching programs. What can people get out of it if they work with you? And just tell us a little bit about what it is that you do for people who come in and work with you.
Well, first of all, you know, it's kind of this weird place because in some ways, I don't really like to call myself a mentor. A lot of these mentor programs, even with you, you know, I'm like, hey, let's go past me, people, and you get mentored by these books, by these things, by, you know, by Warren Buffett, by Charlie Munger, by Jeff Bezos, all this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So I don't know that I totally hold myself out as this role model of perfection. There's a lot of people more successful than me, and a lot of people less successful than me. I'm just a man, you know, I say I'm just a man moving through time. So at some level, I don't want people completely to latch, you know, I want you to latch onto me or me latch onto you, or, but what I can offer is clarity of vision for you to go through something that you see blind spots.
Mm-hmm.
You see a clear path to get away from, specifically around health, wealth, love, happiness. A lot of business stuff that I talk about, because you have to get your finances right. You know, I said there's four levels of finance. You have scarcity, which is, you know, the Daniel Kahneman or whatever, the Nobel Prize guy, says under $70,000, $80,000 a year. So it's scarcity. Then you get to level two, which is independence, financial independence. Level three, prosperity. Maybe you're making 300 to a million a year. Then you get to wealth and impact above a million a year. And so for you and you listening, I think that's a great place to start with finances.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you can't get that one right, it messes with everything else.
Yeah.
So I talk about all kinds of stuff. And so I built out a program. I really started this a long time ago, back in 2004. With one of my companies. So, you know, I developed this back in 2004. The idea was, it's hard, you know, the problem in the world, Joel Salatin was my first mentor, was just out here in Hollywood, and he's like, I don't know how people sleep with all the opportunities. Like, Joel's reality is just that there's money everywhere, there's opportunities, there's excitement. The problem is there's not enough trained people. There's good people out there. There's smart people, but trained, good, smart people, almost non-existent. So started back in 04, you know, and it's gone through different variations. And so now what I have, like what you've gone through and we're continually developing out, is like a white to black belt system. It's like white, yellow, green, blue, orange. And it's just levels. I mean, you know, the belt's a relevant thing, but it's like, and, you know, starting out with mindset stuff, then you're going in entrepreneurial stuff, building million-dollar businesses. We talk about closing deals, persuasion, social. We're almost done. We haven't finished the whole health stuff, but there's a lot of mindset in that. You know, I'm sick right now, and I rarely get sick, and I realized today, I was like, man, that's another one. It's like money. If you don't have health,
mm-hmm.
or if your health is operating subpar, your whole life is subpar. So, and then, of course, social, a lot of stuff on social. Really, people underestimate how important social is. Matt Lieberman in the book Social talks about the basic, fundamental part of being human is to be able to interact socially. That's why we have vocal cords. That's mm-hmm. why we have brain. So you get that one wrong, then you're not even living life. Then you're really a zombie. So you, and then we have all the way, once people get through that, we have the inner circle, which is for more advanced people, depending on, mm-hmm. you know, where you are, you're more in the inner circle, and that's where it's more mentoring stuff like that, events, live and stuff. So there's really stuff for everybody, and you know, I wish I had. I only put this together because I've never seen it done before. I wish somebody else had it. I wish I had had it. Even though I had mentors, a lot of the problem with mentors now, most of my mentors, you know, they weren't formal mentors. I turned them into mentors. So when you can find something formal, it's even better because it's like having a friend who's a doctor who you're sick and he's like, oh, well, you should do this. And he casually gives you advice versus you go in there, you get on the the scanner and he checks x-rays you and checks your blood pressure. Like, people need more formal. You need to know like what you're going through. It's like, okay, and that way you kind of have a sense of time and you're like, okay, am I behind, am I not, and you just track it and you keep going. I tell people, I'd say the most important is the first 67 days and then sticking after that on to 18 months, those two time frames. 67 days, that's what modern research shows how long it takes to rewire your brain. So we have that 67 step program, and then 18 months, which is really how long it takes to go through the other stuff I have that we built. It's not just me, also, it's a lot of interviews, a lot of working with the top people. I'm cool enough thing in my life now is I get, you know, I was just with a guy in Europe, $800 million net worth, and not just money, but fascinating guy, changing the world, doing a lot of good stuff. These are people not even, you know, 30 years old. And how is it like that? I mean, what does that mean for you? I can, all that stuff gets put together into these programs. So it's not just learning from one person. It's learning a collective body of knowledge.
And if you'd like to check out Ty's program or programs, there's a button just below where you're watching this video right now. Just click on that and you can go through and check out some of Ty's programs. So in a nutshell, the viewer is going to get what out of going through one of your programs? You mentioned their money, relationships, how to build a lifelong community of friends and acquaintances,
right?
Perspective, a lot of advanced business stuff, but also for the beginner as well, right?
Like, right, yeah, it's a bit, business. You can't go into the advanced until you are advanced. It's pointless.
But if you're wanting to start your own business, or you have a business, or you're stuck in a rut right now, and maybe you've hit a salary ceiling, or maybe you've hit like a ceiling where you can't seem to break through however much money you've been making, or if you feel like nothing's really happening in your life and you're sick of this, almost like you're directionless, then coming into your program is going to change all that around, right?
Yeah, that, I mean, my big thing is, look, I could tell you this, you need all four of those things at once. You need to get the good life. That's really what people want. Yeah. I mean, look, you want money, but I know a guy, an acquaintance, he's one of the richest men in Middle East. He's young, relatively young, in his 40s, worth about $2 billion, but he's so unhealthy, overweight, that he can't get out of bed. Continually with doctors. He's got his own private 747, but would you want to be that guy? You wouldn't. If I told you, James, I'm going to give you $2 billion, but you can't enjoy it because you will be in a hospital bed for the next 2 years or 10 years or 20. You're going to die probably at 45 from a heart attack. Nobody wants that. You can't. And that's the problem. So much stuff is imbalanced. It's like, and it's hard. I certainly am not a master of it, but I have the intention and the focus. Ty, how can you get the good life? That means health, wealth, love, and happiness without sacrificing one to get the other.
Yeah. So if you want health, wealth, love, and happiness in your life, just click the button below and go through into to Ty's programs. You'll also learn how to read a book a day.
That James can teach you now. James is a master. He's read so many. You know, it's cool working with you. One cool thing is that so many people I've worked with, I mean, you get thousands of people literally emailing me at one time now. My phone, it takes me forever to even load in emails in an hour. And I don't mean that bragging. What I mean is a lot of people are interested, but not enough people have the fire under them to go life is short. Let me do it now. Like, you actually did it, which, you know, is very rare. You actually put in the time to read. I tell people that all the time. And there's not a person in the world that would be like, yeah, my life would be worse off if I was more intelligent. Like Buffett says, the more you learn, the more you earn.
Yeah.
And so you actually did it. And I tell people, man, life's short. Life is a vapor. You know, look back in the past to where you were 10 years ago. You can hardly remember it. And one day, you know, today is the youngest day you will ever be. And to those people, this is another thing Seneca said, you know, life's an investment. If you don't invest in yourself, and people have a hard time. I tell people you should spend 33% of your money on doubling down and reinvesting in your own brain.
Mm-hmm.
Because life is short. If you don't do it now, there's an ancient saying, Rabbi Hillel, he says, if I don't love me, who will? Meaning, if you don't take care of yourself, you don't invest and double down on your own brain, nobody else is going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, do it today.
Yeah.
Tomorrow is not promised. You don't have to freak out, but you have to know there haven't been many days given to you and I, and not productive ones. You know, you're a baby, and then you're too old. So if you're in that narrow window, you better knock it out now, because nobody else is going to do it for you. Life goes on this planet. I could die, you could die. And for the most part, our parents would be sad, few friends, but life keeps going on. So what you got to do is you got to find your place. I say the universe is like a wheel. It's rolling, time, it's moving. It's a big wheel. And most people try to run alongside the wheel. The problem is one day you'll stumble, you'll trip, and you'll fall, and that wheel never stops rolling. It'll just crush you. So what you have to do is, how can you get into the wheel? So you're operating along the natural patterns, cycles, principles, frameworks of this big wheel. And once you're inside, you're safe. And then it doesn't matter whether you're getting older, you're moving towards a direct end game goal. And one of the biggest things that I can help people do, and you'll really be the one doing, just like you, is figuring out your destiny.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get that one right, nothing. Joel Salatin used to tell me, Ty, worst thing in life is getting good at the wrong things.
Yeah, yeah. So invest in yourself is the number one goal.
33% of your time and money in yourself.
And the number one way you can invest in yourself right now is to click the button right below and go through and check out all of Ty Lopez's stuff. Ty, this has been great. Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
I'm James Swanick. He is Ty Lopez. Great to see you.